I would say that's pretty peak right there.
Yeah, that's peak. All right, that's when Arsenio Hall peaked too, right?
Nah, later, you got a show out of that.
Oh, that's right. That came, so Arsenio
he's
was...
coming back, dude. Doesn't he have another show? I think there's another Arsenio Hall show premiering very soon, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, very soon. I mean, listen, it's been 20 years.
Chris Jenner has a talk show now.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, who doesn't?
Well, that's the point.
Yeah,
I mean, would you say that's resurgence from Arsenio?
Yeah, I guess what took him so long? Where have you been?
Quarter to Malusis and Murdy with you. We've done a lot of baseball. Swain did want to mix in a couple other things, really, at the top. And, you know, we'll do a little bit more football over the next couple of days. Certainly, A-Rod's been a big-time theme. And we got some good guests, hopefully, on tap tomorrow. A couple baseball guests that should come through, and we'll really add to it. But the Jets and the saga, we're early on here in training camp. And I want to ask you as far as, and I don't have an issue with it, Idzik, Ryan, the decision maker, Geno Smith, Mark Sanchez. It's not a matter of who you think should be the starting quarterback.
Right.
It's a matter of who do you think should decide should be the starting quarterback. And I have no issue with it being a joint decision between Idzik and Ryan making the call as far as the starter goes. Now, some will say it should be the head coach. He's the one that decides. It should be his thing. The general manager, the coach, you know, the general manager shouldn't have a role in it. I have no issue with Idzik having a role in it.
I agree. I don't think the GM should stay completely out of it. I mean, because what they're both having to work towards is not only this season, but a plan for the future for the New York Jets. So if they can collectively come to an agreement on this, listen, if it's one thing if Rex Ryan says, I want Mark Sanchez to play, and Idzik is saying that you know, no, Geno Smith's starting, and that's the end of it. Now you have an issue. But if they're both talking about it together, they have to come to an agreement. Whether Rex Ryan is part of this future or not, he has to still answer to the GM, and I think there has to be at least some sort of dialogue.
Yeah, and a couple other things for Rex is now, he's not a lame duck coach because he's got 2 years left on his deal, but there have been articles written he's a lame duck coach, they should give him more security. I mean, lame duck, by definition, would be final year. Terry Collins is a lame duck coach.
Right. I think the idea that the leash is pretty short for Rex Ryan with a new GM who didn't hire him.
Right, but I think it's in Rex's best interest to have the general manager help him make the decision for the coach.
Want to come down to the offensive game plan with me? Come on down.
Well, yeah, because then, you know what, if they both decide that what's best for the organization is Geno Smith, he's got a card to play at the end of the season. Like, it's not a matter of, well, Idzik goes, well, you're out. You wanted Sanchez. You wanted this. You wanted that. If it's a group joint decision, then it's one organization moving forward together, and you like that.
And listen, Rex Ryan is blind if he doesn't think that somewhere down the line, Geno Smith is taking over as quarterback. You don't draft a guy that high and decide he's just going to be your backup to a guy who's been embattled the way Mark Sanchez has been. So I think that as long as he's not making waves with the GM, I think it's fine. As long as you guys are talking about it together, there is no problem with the GM being involved in it. If the coach has an issue with it, then you're going to run into a typical Jets-like saga, I guess. But the GM has every right to have some sort of dialogue with the coach.
And say, yeah, I agree. 877-337-6666. Brooklyn Valley goes swing. It's Harry. It's the fans. What's going on, Harry?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, on Harry.
What's up, Harry?
How come David Ortiz gets a pass on the steroids?
Well, we talked about it before. It's not that he gets the pass. It's just that, you know, The people who are getting busted here got busted at a specific place they went to. It's not like everybody's sitting there following Alex Rodriguez around saying, let's go find where he's getting his stuff. Biogenesis was busted. All the players that went to Biogenesis got busted. And guess what? That's where Alex Rodriguez was. If David Ortiz was at Biogenesis, he'd be busted too.
Hey, sweetie, you know something? I met you a long time ago at Mickey Mantle's. You were doing a remote with Scott Farrell.
Wow, that wasn't... No, you know what? It wasn't Mantle's we were at. Scotty and I were at Rosie O'Grady's.
Oh,
that's
really? I thought it was Mickey Mantle.
No. Scotty and I did a show. It was his show. He'd just come on FAN. It was the bar underneath Rosie O'Grady's. Maxwell's, the place below street level.
Okay.
At Rosie O'Grady's over there. And that was a long time. That was 90.
I think you guys should bring your stuff around to replace Todd because he's a bum.
No. Listen, you know what happened that night?
What's that?
This was 1996. It was right around the Final Four. It was at the Meadowlands.
Okay, yeah.
Syracuse is in that
Syracuse.
John Wallace.
Kentucky in the final.
About, I don't know, about halfway through the show, this guy comes down, he's down the stairs, he's standing in the stairway, watching Pharrell do his crazy thing.
Yeah.
And Pharrell's got a great audience there, and I was helping produce the show. Look up, someone says to me, hey, look who's there. It was David Letterman. Letterman's standing there in a leather jacket, baseball cap pulled down, and he's just kind of watching, he's staring. This big, pretty big fan of Pharrell, as we found out later on. But I go over to him and I ask him, I said, hi, Dave, Sweeney Murdy, FAN. He said, do you want to say hi to Scott? You want to come on the show?
Yeah.
No, just here to watch. So I said, no, come on. I said, I'm sure Scott would love to have you. And I put my hand on like his shoulder, just kind of like, hey, come on over. And he looks at me, he goes, let go of me. Oh, no, yeah, sorry. I said, listen, he didn't want to come on. I said, listen, well, he's about to go to a break in about 2 minutes. I said, do you want to meet him? 2 minutes? Yes, sir. I'll bring him right over to you. Okay. So Scotty goes to commercial break. He towels off because he's a mess during his show. He goes over and shakes hands with Dave. They, you know, just say hi. The crowd all of a sudden realizes who it is. They start saying, Dave. Beeline went back up the stairs and out the door. He was gone. As soon as people recognized him. But Scotty has been on Letterman several times, you know, all because I convinced Dave to stay there. And I at least I'd like to see
him.
I have something to do.
Let
me believe it.
The Letterman Pharrell bond and Sweeney Murdy.
Just let me believe it.
We all believe it. 151. Melusis and Murdy with you, the Fed in New York.
Hi, it's Brad Benson from Brad Benson Hyundai in South Brunswick, New Jersey. Hey, let's go. Politics in New York. We've got ex-governor and call girl aficionado Elliot Spitzer running for controller, and ex-congressman and weenie selfie sender Anthony Weiner running for mayor. Imagine their appointees. Charlie Sheen could run the vice squad. Lindsay Lohan, liquor commissioner. Hey, with Weiner and Spitzer at the helm, one of the dirtiest governments since Clinton was handing out cigars in the Oval Office. Wait a second. I'm a car dealer. Shouldn't I be screaming about a bunch of phony baloney this weekend only deals? Well, I figure I don't have to. We're the biggest single local.